So AI may not take your job, but you will probably, you could lose your job to someone who uses AI better than you. So I'm Professor Wray Buntine, and I'm here to talk about the new AI. But here's my background. So at the age of five, my nickname was the Professor. There you go. I do large language models, but I did an earlier version about 10 years ago. And then about 5 or 6 years ago, it became apparent that my field was disappearing. It vanished very quickly. And a new field came up, which was deep learning and deep learning large language models. And these are what I'm talking about. Hopefully, you've seen some of these. ChatGPT is the one that's best known. There's also some that have been developed for the Vietnamese language. But could I ask, how many people have used ChatGPT? Can we have a look? Yes, so we have a pretty good, we've got a good knowledge here then about this, I would say. So first off, let's just have a brief introduction. Now, ChatGPT, you have a conversation with the AI. That's the difference. And I get it to do fun little memes, but I also get it to help me with my teaching, and it's really good at that. It can solve most of the problems, the student questions I give it. It also does these amazing videos, that's more recently. But let's talk about the situation here in Vietnam. So we have really two areas. We've got the areas where big money, the huge multinationals are going to come in. And they'll be doing humanoid robots, movie generation. But we also have areas where I think smaller businesses, startups, and there's no doubt there's some young person here in the room who may have a go at this. Things like personal AI agents. So these are coming on, but I'm not talking about this. I want to talk about what I think are the fundamentals. So I'm interested in education and healthcare because, that's part of what I do, right? So that's what I think is important. Now, healthcare has huge applications for these, and there's a lot of big money going into this, and a lot of successful applications are coming about. But Vietnam's a bit different, right? A lot of the doctors here don't have a great English. But also, you know, Western healthcare is pretty expensive. I know that. And I think prevention is way more important, and there's not enough of that. But also education. Wow, there's all these books about education in how to use things like ChatGPT for education. And there's a lot of uses, and I know that. Who has used some kind of Gen AI to answer questions for school or university? Who's actually gets them to help it? Wow, look at all those people saying yes. By the way, I had a resume given to me recently. It was clearly written by ChatGPT. I could tell. And I wasn't impressed. Just keep that in mind. So this is a typical Vietnamese classroom, right? Maybe out in the country areas, not a lot of computers here. It's probably quite a few smartphones though. So we've got to think that situations here are a bit different. But I think Vietnam is well positioned for this situation. There's really good telecommunications. There's a vibrant startup community, which I hope you've observed here. We've seen it in the shorts earlier. The government is starting to put in place policies to encourage the right things. And we think there will be a strong economy in this area pretty soon. So let's have a look about the successes and where Gen AI is going. So first off, Gen AI is very good at doing exams. SAT, LSAT, all sorts of them. It gets a pass in a bar exam for law and a general medical exam. It's pretty impressive. So a lot of companies are building systems for this. So what we have here, the example is Companies are using it to assist their programmers. They can get a 30% boost in productivity. It's used for drug discovery, for law, for nursing, and there's a lot of money going into hardware to support it, right? Things are happening. Now, here we have Elon Musk, right? I hope you recognized him. What he's saying, he's talking about the explosion of artificial intelligence. He's never seen a field explode so quickly. And it's the same for us. We're overwhelmed in the academic community. And this is what some of the people are talking about, a Cambrian explosion. So if you know your biology, that would make something. So just a crazy number of new capabilities are coming on. But on the other side, with that explosion, things are hotting up. They're just getting quicker and quicker. We may lose control, right? Certainly, I feel in our education we're losing control. You know, it's just happening so fast. And it's really hard to keep up. But there's also a lot of hype going on. Now, this plot here is just sort of conceptual. But you'll see expectations is the y-axis. And expectations are really high right now, right? Loads of promises. It's a lot of hype. Some of it's going to come true. We've already seen the successes. This is amazing. So what we're going to have is, there really is a knowledge revolution. So the knowledge workers, the people who didn't lose their job with the robot, will lose their jobs now, the laptop class. And we're going to see that, I think, in the next decade. You will find a lot of your systems soon will be managed by these, right? Your laptop will now be managed. You won't have to use strange systems to update your laptop. Finally, the more moneyed of us will have our own personalized agent. And that agent will give us good health advice, manage our finances, manage our meetings, maybe interview people. It's going to change things. And one thing I believe is that big companies, for the big companies, if they're not doing this, using it throughout their environment, they're going to lose out, right? And for that, you need good computing power and a lot of electricity, because this stuff uses power like anything. So that's where we're headed. Let's go to the next stage. I want to briefly tell you about how it works. Well, actually, I'm cheating. This is not how it works. This is my steampunk version and a Terminator version. This is just having fun with Dali, right? So this is my version. This is a professor's cute little diagram of how it works. The thing I want you to look at first off is you get all this content, and that's more content than you could read in 20 years. No one could ever absorb all of this. It's way too much. Then you get the system to train on that content. Then you get the system to train with conversations. Then you have to train the system to do acceptable conversations. And what that means is it can't be telling you about harm. It can't tell you how to damage yourself. It also can't be handing out proprietary information or copyright information. Also, it's got to be objective. It can't be subjective. So if you say, well, what do you think of Donald Trump? It's got to be objective. Well, on the positive side, on the negative side, it's got to give both sides. And finally, there's the reasoning part. Now, how do you solve a hard problem? 2 seconds, bang, I've got the answer. No. You deliberate, you think, you look at alternatives, you think it over. That's how we should be using this system. There we go. Now, so far I've talked about text, but if you're learning physics, you use diagrams, right? Same with medicine, same with math. So the modern systems, just recently, last 6 months maybe, they're incorporating images and they're doing the whole thing. So this is a huge leap forward in recent times. So what's wrong with all of this? What are the potential problems? Well, any of those parts, any of the parts I've talked about, can have problems, right? They can have errors in them. Well, issues is what I'd say. The first thing is, one thing you've got to realize is that some things, there's a lot of conflicting information. If you put an American Democrat and an American Republican in a room together, they're going to say completely different things. They've got a completely different view of the world. And that's the input you're giving to the system. And it's actually the same with research. You see, if you're doing research like me or medical research, there's a lot we don't know. And there's a lot of arguments. You know, scientists can get quite angry and tribal about their own particular field. There's a lot of things going on because we don't know the answers yet in a lot of stuff. The other thing the system misses is complex reasoning. Remember I was talking about that the current systems are basically responding. It's a very simple system, but here we need to make that reasoning more scientific, more logical, and that hasn't been done yet. So this is the outcome of that. People say the system is producing a confabulation. Now, that's the term I'm given to from psychologists. So the idea is it'll generally give you a consensus view. It'll give you the dominant view. If it doesn't know much, you know it's a really convincing guesser, right? It'll give you stuff and you'll believe it. People are fooled by its output. It's so clever. So that's our problem. Now, I'm going to call this problem truthiness. Now, if there's anyone older in the room, you may remember Stephen Colbert, who's now a talk show host in the US. But he, in 2006, he introduced a new word to the world. It was truthiness. Truthiness is not truth. It's stuff that, well, sounds truthful. You believe it. You want to believe it. It just sounds good. So that's exactly what these systems are giving us now. They're really good at delivering truthiness. Now, there's many ways we can get truth wrong, and I just want to briefly talk about some of them. There may be no established truth yet, so it's medical research, it's physics research, where people are still arguing. It may be misinformation, and that can come for many reasons. One of my favourites, though, is when industries are trying to suppress stuff, and the best example is tobacco science. Look that up, there's a great movie on it. But the tobacco industry produced a whole lot of sham science to prevent people from discovering that smoking was bad for you. That's misinformation, right? And finally, there's what I call the noble lie. So the noble lie is where the authorities decide, you know, they've got an important policy and they don't want to give the fine details or the nuances. So they suppress a few things, right? They don't let us in on those things. And that happened a lot during COVID, or so we're discovering afterwards. And here's a really good guide that you'll get now. Some people are giving this to their, like, first-year university students. I think all first-year university students should have a little bit of training in spotting misinformation. Really, really good advice. This is great stuff. But I will warn you, it's a field of information warfare. One thing you have to realize is when you get to areas like, say, medicine or my area, it's really hard to spot this stuff, right? It's really difficult. And I'm a reviewer for journals and conferences, so I know just how difficult it can get. Now, here's an example I'll race through to give you. About 10 years ago, I was pretty sick, but let's have a look at that. So my friend has diabetes. How can reduce the impact of it? They basically gave me the American Diabetics Association story. That's the right answer, right? Then I said, well, that's good advice. Does it ever get cured? Ooh, can you, you know, fix yourself up? It tells me, well, not really. There is a thing called remission. So I ask it, is there a diet that would lead to remission? Reasonable question. You talk for a while. And it mentioned a diet called the low-calorie diet. Now, I've got to say, that means a starvation diet, if you haven't figured it out. Not something I'd want to do. Are there any... I'm a scientist. I want to know, you know, tell me some facts, some data. So is there any randomized controlled trials for this? That's my next question. Well, yes, there is. But what it didn't tell me, and what I already knew about, was there's something called the Verta trial. So it didn't tell me this other randomized controlled trial. It kind of hid it from me. And I happen to know that. Now, what's going on here? So this to me was a problem. what's going on here? It's giving me the dominant view. It's giving me the net consensus. And the American Diabetics Association hasn't yet accepted the Virta trial as, well, we're not sure of this. So I call this settled science, right? There's the problem of when does science decide that facts are fixed or not? That's a problem. When do we know when the facts are settled and we shouldn't worry? And there's been a lot of famous cases where people feel, oh yeah, things are settled. The Earth is round. The Earth is flat. Oh no, it's settled. Earth is at the center of the universe. In science, things don't really get settled, and we always have to be aware of new possibilities. And so that's, to me, related to this diabetic situation. Now, Elon Musk here is talking about going for truth. He's building one of these systems, it's called Grok, and for him an important thing is getting truth. Now, as a researcher, that's what I want. And for the medical community here in Vietnam, I want to see them get the truth, right? I want to see them get the range of possibilities, not just what the others have said. So there we go. That's what I'm telling you today. I think we can build a Gen AI that's affordable, it's locally managed, and it's truthful, right? To me, that's the goal. And I believe that would be a great advantage for the students in, you know, developing countries and healthcare as well. Thank you.